In August of 1955, 14-year-old Emmett Till traveled from his home in Chicago to visit his family in Money, Mississippi. While standing with his cousins and some friends outside Bryant's grocery store, Emmett bragged that his girlfriend back home was white. Emmett's companions didn't believe him and dared him to ask the white woman sitting behind the counter for a date. Emmett went in, bought some candy, and on the way out was heard saying, "Bye, baby," to the woman behind the counter. It was later reported that he also wolf-whistled at her as he left. There were no witnesses in the store but Carolyn Bryant. The same woman would later claim that Emmett had grabbed and made lewd advances at her. A few days later, Carolyn Bryant's husband, Roy Bryant, returned home from a business trip and was quickly told of how Emmett Till allegedly spoke to his wife. With his half-brother, J.W. Milam, Bryant drove to the home of Till's great-uncle, Mose Wright, where Till was staying while vacationing in Money, Mississippi. In the middle of the night, the two men dragged Emmett from the home, drove away, and proceeded to beat, torture, and kill Emmett before dumping his body in the Tallahatchie River. 3 days later, his body was recovered. The body was so disfigured that Mose Wright could barely identify it. Local authorities of Money, Mississippi wanted the body buried quickly, but Emmett's mother, Mamie Till Mobley, intervened and requested it be sent back to Chicago. The undertaker of the funeral home, Mr. Rayner, asked Miss Mobley if he wanted her to retouch the body. Miss Mobley responded, "No, Mr. Rayner. Let the people see what I have seen. I want the world to see what is going on in Mississippi, in this great whole United States of America." Miss Mobley held a funeral for Emmett, where she demanded Emmett's body be displayed in an open casket. The story and images of Emmett Till's body was picked up by Jet Magazine and spread across the nation. The vivid image of Emmett Till's body was viewed by millions of Americans in every state of the nation. A month later, an all-white jury in Tallahatchie County, Mississippi, acquitted both Roy Bryant and John Milam, the two white men responsible for Emmett Till's murder. Years later, both Bryant and Milam would admit to the death of Emmett Till. In many ways, the modern civil rights movement began with the single brave choice of a grieving mother to show the world the brutality and hatred the American South had for African Americans in the 20th century. So just like last week, I wanted to start with a very specifically scripted narrative to get us started. Admittedly, the narrative of Emmett Till is not an easy story to handle. And it is for that reason that it's all the more important for us as we move into the civil rights movement. In many ways, the narrative of Emmett Till that gets spread throughout the country becomes a spark to the larger movement that we're going to spend the better part of these next two Ed Puzzle lectures talking about. Okay, so our story really begins on March 2nd, 1955. We have a young black girl who is 15 years old, who in school had actually just recently started to learn about a lot of the black leaders who made a real difference throughout American history. People like Sojourner Truth and Harriet Tubman, and the kind of role the Underground Railroad played in allowing for the abolition of slavery. And so with these leaders in mind, this young girl gets on a bus. And now, admittedly, during the 1950s, we have to remember that black and white passengers were treated completely differently. There was about 10 rows of seats for white people at the front of the bus and about 10 rows of seats at the back of the bus for black passengers. Now, there's a middle section where basically either group can sit. And it just so happens that our young student is sitting there in the middle section, and in the process of the bus filling up, they ask her to get up and leave her seat. And with these people like Sojourner Truth and Harriet Tubman in her mind, she says no and refuses to move to the back of the bus and is convinced that if they're going to move her, they're going to have to take her out on their own. And so naturally, as you would expect, the bus stops, the authorities are called, and this young girl is removed from the bus and arrested. And that student is Claudette Colvin. Now, Claudette Colvin is one of many young black activists who are actively resisting these segregation laws when it comes to public transportation and specifically buses. Now, I bring up this story because Claudette Colvin, on March 2nd, 1955, is actually taking part 9 months before the much more heralded story of Rosa Parks. And yet there's a reason why, even today, more than likely, most people have heard about Rosa Parks and not Claudette Colvin. And that brings us to the NAACP. For a long time, the NAACP had been attempting to find a case that they could use to help push back against segregation laws when it comes to public transportation. They saw the case of Claudette Colvin, and they rejected using this case as one that they could potentially take before the Supreme Court and effect real change. Number one, they thought she was too young. And number two, they thought she was too dark. And so it's significant for us to realize that even though in this kind of civil rights moment, there are so many more people than I could ever possibly tell you about. And the story of Claudette Colvin is only one of millions that are out there that are so significant. Despite her role, Claudette Colvin's story is just one of many that precedes the much more well-known story of Rosa Parks, who 9 months later, as an active member of the NAACP herself, is going to similarly refuse to give up her seat. Now, naturally, just like Colvin, Rosa Parks is arrested and removed from the bus. Now, unlike Colvin, Rosa Parks was much older and much lighter skinned. So the NAACP jumps on this opportunity to pick up Rosa Parks' case. And the effect is going to ultimately be incredibly transformative. Now, the question becomes, what was in Rosa Parks' head when she was thinking about this? Now, admittedly, no one knows for sure. People like to suggest that Rosa Parks was really tired of having to get up and just move out of this area, and it was just becoming too much to bear. Later in her life, she actually is going to say that people used to always say that I didn't give up my seat because I was tired. But that isn't true. The only tired I was tired of giving in. And admittedly, a lot of people tend to believe that the case of Emmett Till, which had only happened a few months prior, was one of these kind of thoughts that was, for the most part, probably in her head at the time that she chose to make this decision. And it's at this moment where we begin to see this proliferation and blossoming in the civil rights movement around this specific type of resistance we're gonna see in what becomes Montgomery, Alabama. So after Rosa Parks is arrested, news spreads pretty quickly that Rosa Parks, a member of the NAACP, a pretty well-respected member of the community, has been thrown in jail, and that demands some type of action from the residents of Montgomery, Alabama. And so the solution that they come up with is an incredibly American one, going way back to the Revolutionary War itself. The people of Montgomery, Alabama, decide to wage a boycott on the bus system of Montgomery. Now, you might think, well, that might not have a huge impact. For example, Montgomery bus riders who were black made up about 80% of the entire revenue generated by the Montgomery bus system. To the point where, when this Montgomery bus boycott is in full swing, the bus system is losing about $3,000 a day. Additionally, the Montgomery bus boycott is also going to see the emergence of by far one of the more well-known figures of the civil rights movement, Martin Luther King Jr. He arrives in Montgomery, Alabama to be the local pastor of a Baptist church. Despite the organizational capacity of the specific group that Rosa Parks is a part of, which is the Women's Political Council of Montgomery, MLK is going to be chosen as the leader and figurehead of this movement. It's incredibly important to note that just because MLK is the leader of this specific movement, or the figurehead of it, does not diminish from the work of all of the other grassroots organizers in Montgomery. Specifically, without the women of Montgomery helping to coordinate these patterns for how do we get to work if we don't ride the bus, people organize carpools, bikes, walking routes. The entire community is rallied into this common cause, and it goes on for 381 days. And if you want to do the math on $3,000 a day for 381 days, you can imagine the economic hit that the city of Montgomery is taking as a result of this action. And so the reason for the success of this movement is because of its grassroots organization. Because you have women and men in this intimate location of Montgomery working together to find a way to actually push back against the segregation that is happening on the buses of Montgomery. Now, ultimately, again, about a year after this bus boycott starts, the Supreme Court is going to step in and rule that public segregation on these public transportation is unconstitutional. And so the boycott is going to end in triumph. People look at this as an incredible moment for the civil rights movement. MLK is brought into national fame. And so by the end of the 1950s, you see several victories for the civil rights movement as a whole. You see the victory of Brown v. Board of Education ending segregation in education, at least delivering some type of promise for it. You then see the Supreme Court stepping in and ending segregation on public transportation. When you then couple that with the general lack of concern of President Eisenhower for civil rights as a whole and not wanting to get involved and having to deal with the kind of issues that it could potentially bring up for him politically, the civil rights movement goes into a little bit of a lull towards the end of the 1950s. That all changes though when you get to the 1960s and you go through an incredibly transformative moment in American society. And just like we saw an initial flourishing of the civil rights movement in Montgomery, Alabama, you see these pockets of resistance develop in various places across the American South. This next one is going to occur in Greensboro, North Carolina. On the afternoon of February 1st, 1960, right at the start of 1960 in this brand new potential era of American history, four students from North Carolina Agricultural and Technical State University, an entirely black college in Greensboro, North Carolina, are going to enter into the local Woolworth's department store. Now, all these students, they kind of do what they normally would. They walk around the store, they make some purchases, and then they actually make the decision to sit down at the lunch counter. Now, admittedly, this is an incredibly big deal at the time. The lunch counter was specifically reserved for whites. And so the waitress comes over and tells them, "You're not gonna be served here, you'll need to leave." Those four students stay in those seats for the rest of the day until the store closes. When the store closes, they get up, they leave, and they do the exact same thing the next day and then the next day. And so with this is born the sit-in movement within the larger civil rights movement. And so this Greensboro sit-in, which is what we see in Greensboro, North Carolina, is going to spark similar protests across the South. And so the real principle here of what we're talking about is going to be the idea of getting in the way. And this is the mindset that these civil rights activists have of getting in the way. And yet they're also promoting this doctrine of nonviolence, which had really been espoused by some of the other civil rights organizations, which we'll talk about in a second, MLK, and this new group of students who are now rising up within the movement. Now, the Greensboro movement, as it kind of spreads its message across the South, is going to kind of inspire people to work towards the integration not only of lunch counters, but of parks, pools, restaurants, bowling alleys, libraries, you name it. Anything on the table that is a significant example of segregation in the American South, these activists are now actively attempting to end segregation and demand integration in these areas. And a course of nonviolence is incredibly important for this movement, because as we will see time and time again, you will see that violence is going to be a part of this movement. That as Black men and women and white activists with them put themselves in the way of these established segregationist policies, violence is the natural effect. And so some of these sit-ins have ultimately violence as the effect, where people will have things thrown at them. People will have food thrown at them. They will be violently accosted. And it makes the process of being nonviolent that much harder, to the point where civil rights activists are so aware of what's going to happen that before they let anybody actually go to these sit-ins, they train them just like you would train for a game. And so you would see that civil rights activists would be brought in, and you would have people who are veteran members of these organizations calling them every name in the book, blowing smoke in their face, making sure that by the time they actually went to these sit-ins, that they were incredibly aware of the potential conditions that they were facing. Now again, the purpose was get in the way, show the world the kind of violent backlash that happens within the South, and then demand change from the politicians to end segregation in these locations that we've already seen. Now, as you study the civil rights movement, you will notice there are a lot of acronyms and there's a lot of organizations all pushing for the same thing, and yet they're all pushing for it in a slightly different way. So it is important for us to understand the specific differences that are happening as a result. Before we even talk about a single organization, what is the ultimate goal of the civil rights movement? The two main goals of the civil rights movement is, number one, ending Jim Crow segregation in the American South, and number two, reestablishing African-American suffrage throughout the United States. And so despite any kind of differences in the organizational capacity that we'll see of these civil rights organizations, they're all seeking the same thing. Let's find a way to get Black people voting in America, and we're going to end segregation throughout the country. So the first group is actually a group we've seen for units now. The NAACP, or the National Association for the Advancement of Colored People, which is first founded way back in 1909. We're talking about a movement that has been a part of American history for the better part of a half of a century. And so for most people, when we look at the kind of movement of civil rights organizations, the NAACP is going to be the most popular, at least in the 1950s and the 1960s. And so the reason why this movement is the most popular is it's the longest tenured, number one, and number two, the way in which it goes about trying to affect change. And so you'll see, even way back when W.E.B. Du Bois at least first started the NAACP, this has always had an attempt of trying to find legal means of ensuring Black equality in America. And more recently in the class, the Brown v. Board of Education decision, which again was led by the NAACP and Thurgood Marshall, demonstrates this overall philosophy of using the courts to affect change within American society as it relates to the African-American experience. The second group is a new one, and that's CORE, or the Congress of Racial Equality. And so this is a group that's first founded in 1942, so right in the middle of World War II. And so this is a group that is founded by interracial students. Now, again, like other organizations, they are pioneering this use of nonviolence as a major method or ideology of their movement. And they're going to be responsible for a lot of the sit-ins we've seen. They're also going to be incredibly important for a movement that happens right at the start of 1961, which are the Freedom Rides. And so the Freedom Rides are going to be a movement led by white and Black freedom riders who travel on buses into the Deep South to challenge a recent compliance law that is put on the books that demands the end of segregation in these interstate bus terminals throughout the South. So ultimately, you show up in a bus terminal, you shouldn't have segregation there. You should be able to go to whatever bathroom you want, whatever kind of facilities should be ended. And so these freedom riders that are kind of inspired and a part of CORE are going throughout the South, testing these laws to see if they are able to actually use the facilities, if they're segregated, and pushing for change as they go. Now, admittedly, as these Freedom Riders move further and further into the South, they meet plenty of opposition. You'll see that a lot of these buses are actually bombed, and that in certain instances, the KKK actually intervenes and attacks these buses. So this is by far not a movement that is without its risks. The Freedom Riders themselves are having to experience just as much violence as any other wing of the civil rights movement. The third organization we're going to talk about is the Southern Christian Leadership Conference. And so this is an organization that is started actually by MLK just after the Montgomery bus boycotts. He realizes that he needs some type of organization for like-minded people like himself to actually be able to affect change. And so in Atlanta, Georgia in 1957, he starts this organization specifically composed of mainly Southern preachers. But like CORE, who they do a lot of work with, the SCLC is going to be primarily dedicated to this purpose of nonviolence, while also maintaining this more religious aspect to it. Now, the final group that we're going to talk about, at least for now, is SNCC. And it's pronounced SNCC. It looks somewhat like SNCC, but the widely accepted pronunciation for that is SNCC, or the Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee. And SNCC is really significant because this is the embodiment of the youth movement in the civil rights movement. And so this one is going to be the last that's founded, at least in this period we're talking about. It's founded in 1960, and it's being founded in the wake of these sit-ins that are occurring. It is all these students who see the work that CORE has been doing with all of these sit-ins across the South and is inspired to try and achieve some type of change similar to that. Now, with SNCC, you're going to see them time and time again as a vent system for a lot of the student frustrations that young Black people have throughout the South. And so while all of these organizations have the exact same goal of ending segregation and providing Black people with the opportunity to vote across the United States, it's important to remember that they do differ in the methods and means by which they get there. And so one of the key kind of problems that faces the civil rights movement is that you have so many people engaged in it, and yet they differ in some terms on how exactly the movement should proceed. And it's going to become even more complicated when we bring in more and more groups that are much more drastically differing in how they think that should happen. And so just a heads up for this last section, it's going to move fast and it's going to follow specifically the civil rights movement. And so you'll see presidents kind of come and go. We will do a better job of maintaining the kind of political flow in class. Right now, just worry about civil rights and what is achieved as a result of their work. The political stuff will work itself out. Might even have to make a timeline or two to make sure that this entire unit is fully fleshed out. But we'll get there. Now what we're going to focus on is as the civil rights movement proceeds into the 1960s, we reach a point where ultimately we would call it the high point of the civil rights movement. Specifically, the high point of protest in the civil rights movement, which happens right around the spring of 1963. And so at this time, you're seeing demonstrations taking place in towns, cities across the South, and this discontent that is happening about the inequality in education and employment and housing has never been more prominent than it is in 1963. For example, one week in June of 1963, you have 15,000 arrests of young Black activists in 186 cities. It is a nationwide phenomena and it is a huge nationwide movement. So it's at this point where we're gonna turn our attention back to Alabama. And so specifically we're talking about Birmingham, Alabama, as opposed to Montgomery, which we saw last time. Now Birmingham becomes a center of heated protest for the civil rights movement in 1963. The movement in Birmingham at this point really was kind of floundering, and so the people living in Birmingham decided to call in Martin Luther King Jr. to kind of reinvigorate the movement within Birmingham. Now, when he's there, part of the reason why he shows up is because he knows the type of people running Birmingham are going to be very willing to meet this movement with violence. And so when he shows up, there is a order saying there are no demonstrations to be had in Birmingham. And so MLK shows up, has a demonstration, and he gets thrown in jail for 9 days. And so it's at this time, when he is in the Birmingham jail, that he is going to write by far one of his more famous letters that is going to become kind of emblematic of what the movement really means to him. And so if we had more time, I would love to have us read the letters of Birmingham jail. I'm going to include it in this Ed Puzzle in case you want to read it. I recommend it. It's fantastic. Even if you just glance at it for a little bit, you'll get a good sense of the type of resistance that MLK is experiencing in Birmingham, not only from the white members of Birmingham, but also from blacks as well. And so it's a really fascinating thing to look at, where MLK is meeting so much resistance, and yet he continues with this process of pushing for civil rights despite all of this pushback. And so it's during this period, once MLK is actually out of jail, that he's going to make a decision to actually send out black school children as a part of this movement within Birmingham, Alabama. And there's one thing that MLK knows, and it's that the police chief, Eugene Bull Connor, is going to unleash his forces if he sends out his civil rights activists into the streets. And so thousands upon thousands of young marchers, ranging in age from actual children to all the way up to high schoolers, march in the streets protesting segregation in Birmingham, Alabama. And what we get is going to be pictures and videos of the events that spread across the country. And so you see the violence and the actual backlash against these young students who are attempting to push back against segregation. And it's these images that become so incredibly powerful for the movement. Not only do you see young children march through the streets by police officers and members of the Birmingham Police Force, these images and videos become so incredibly important because they show the violence and the anger that is maintained within the American South as it relates to this civil rights movement. And so it's forcing the rest of the country to really wrestle with this issue of, okay, well, which side am I on here? Because it seems obvious, and yet it's really complicated at this point in American history. And so this is something that actually does endear many Americans to the cause, seeing the nonviolent practice and the violent backlash of the segregationists in the American South. Equally as importantly, the Birmingham movement itself is going to convince John F. Kennedy, the president during the initial years of 1960s, to actually support the goals, not the movement, the goals of the civil rights movement. To the point where John F. Kennedy then pushes forward with a civil rights bill, attempting to at least grant some of these requests of ending segregation in public accommodations throughout the American South. Now, with President Kennedy at least supporting the goals of the movement, the next phase becomes one that more than likely everyone in this class has heard about. And so in late August of 1963, there is a coalition of organizations that come together. Liberals that are both white and black and members of the civil rights movement come together and organize this coalition of civil rights, labor, church organizations. And at the center of them is A. Philip Randolph. Now, if we go back to the World War II years, A. Philip Randolph had actually threatened to do this exact kind of march. And FDR had kind of said, whoa, no, please don't. We'll, you know, allow for black people to serve in these government positions. Please don't do that. That'd be really bad for us at this point in time. And so it's at this point in the 1960s where A. Philip Randolph is going to make good on that promise and help organize this massive march on Washington, D.C. to protest several things. It's not just civil rights, and that's a really significant thing to focus on. This march on Washington that happens in 1963, yes, one of the central goals is to protest segregation and advance the goals of the civil rights movement. But this is also a movement that is also tied pretty closely with the liberal wing of American politics. And so what you see is that ultimately labor and the civil rights movement come together to the point where this movement, this March on Washington, is actually referred to as the March on Washington for Jobs and Freedom. And so what this is really doing is it's revealing this really unprecedented degree of black and white cooperation in the civil rights movement. And so it's important to recognize that fact, that even though you have differences across racial lines, these socioeconomic issues do transcend that, at least at times, and in 1963 for sure, to the point where you see people like MLK get up on the stage and deliver his I Have a Dream speech. And yet is much more diverse of a cause than just civil rights. It is advancing the causes of a lot of the issues that we've seen up until this point in the class, dating back to the Gilded Age and the kind of trampling of the American worker. Now, I don't want to oversell it and undermine the kind of civil rights aspect of it, because by far, one of the most significant elements of this march is going to be the civil rights element to it. MLK's speech that he delivers at the Washington Monument is one of the tried and true statements of American history. And so the ultimate effect that we see from this march on Washington is one of hope, is one of attempting to guarantee the basic rights of African Americans and American workers as a whole across the board during the early 1960s. A lot of that gets thrown into chaos when John F. Kennedy is killed in 1963. Now, admittedly, we're not going to talk too much about JFK's assassination at this point in time. Since it's in the context of the civil rights movement, the question becomes, what's his vice president going to do? If JFK was just now getting on board with what is going on, how is Lyndon B. Johnson going to take over? And is he going to advance the cause of the civil rights movement? Or is he going to turn his back on it? And that becomes a really significant question as you are almost at the point where the civil rights movement feels like they have got a civil rights bill almost passed. It's not too sincere of a statement to say that nobody in the civil rights movement could have anticipated how much LBJ would support the civil rights movement at home. When he becomes president, 5 days after JFK has been assassinated, he goes before Congress and demands that Congress pass Kennedy's civil rights bill. This bill that would provide for guarantees of integration in all public facilities and ultimately would end Jim Crow segregation across the South. Now, it's thanks to the sit-ins, it's thanks to the boycotts, and it's thanks to the marches that have happened and to the unity across the civil rights movement that in 1964, with the help of LBJ, Congress is going to pass the Civil Rights Act, which is going to prohibit racial discrimination in employment, institutions like hospitals and schools, and privately owned public accommodations, such as restaurants, hotels, and theaters. And so this is a landmark case. At a moment where the civil rights movement could have derailed, the support from LBJ at this point in the executive office is going to push through with this civil rights bill that is going to transform the American South in ways that just years before people wouldn't have anticipated. And so with the civil rights bill, Jim Crow segregation is ultimately dead, at least constitutionally. Now, one of the key omissions of the Civil Rights Act is the voting rights portion, which was previously in it but removed to gain the required number of congressmen to pass the law. And so the civil rights organizers themselves recognize that the Civil Rights Act is significant, but it's a half measure that only achieves half of their goals, which we talked about at the start, of ending segregation and passing a law that will ensure voting rights for all Black people in the United States. And so in the summer of 1964, that becomes the focus. Members from all different sorts of civil rights groups, whether it's SNCC, CORE, NAACP, are all going to launch a campaign to push voter registration across the South, knowing full well they're going to experience resistance. And so they focus on one state in particular, and that state is Mississippi. And so in Mississippi, the civil rights organizers recognize that there is a fraction of a percentage of Black people who have been able to vote. And so it's their mission to go into Mississippi and help Black people vote. And so this becomes known as Freedom Summer. And Freedom Summer really has two main goals. Primarily, this is going to be helped and pushed through by SNCC. And so SNCC is going to send Black and white students to Mississippi with two main goals. Number one, register people to vote. Help them find ways to vote. And number two, they're going to establish what we call freedom schools for young people. And so ultimately, freedom schools are going to be these institutions that during the summer months would help young Black people to get caught up in education that they should have been given throughout the year. Now, this is a moment in the civil rights movement where you're going to see SNCC and these other civil rights organizers come into the Mississippi Delta and really begin to create relationships with the people there and trying to find ways to help them advance themselves within Mississippi. It's not just a thing where people show up and say, hey, I'm here to help you and leave. This is a situation where there are organizers who are actively there attempting to effect real change in Mississippi. Now all of this goes awry when in June, three young activists are killed and left in a ditch. Two of the activists, Michael Schwerner and Andrew Goodman, are two white Northerners who had come down in this Freedom Summer movement to try and help out young black people in Mississippi. The third member, James Chaney, is actually a local black youth who is a part of this movement and been a part of this group with Schwerner and Goodman. And so all three of these people are kidnapped and then they are killed for their part in this role. Now, this throws everything into awry as people look at this, and it really shocks a lot of people. Now, admittedly, the reason why it shocks people is because Northern white men have now been killed in this cause. And that really makes people second guess what the heck is going on in the South and causes them to reevaluate what their priorities are and what exactly it means to be an American at this point in time. And so it's shortly after this, where in January in 1965, so only a few months later, that MLK is going to launch his voting rights campaign in Selma, Alabama. And this is the incredibly significant moment where, again, the use of nonviolence becomes so incredibly important here. In Selma, Alabama, you see about 2%, like you see in other parts of the state, 2% of the black population can vote. And so it's MLK's goal of moving in there and helping to lead this campaign for voting rights. So in March, King is completely going to ignore the request by Governor Wallace of Alabama to halt this march for the Selma community. And he's going to lead this march out of Selma to the state capitol. It is when they cross over the Selma Bridge that they are going to encounter the state police, who are equipped with tear gas, with cattle prods, whips, and an assortment of other weaponry. And so the marchers themselves, in what becomes known as Bloody Sunday, are subject to violence, again, that is not only recorded, but is also going to be shared across the nation as 50 plus people in this march are hospitalized after the violence that has been inflicted on them by the Alabama State Police. Future Congressman John Lewis is chief among them, who is actually at the front of this, suffers a fractured skull in the process. Now again, the same theme develops here throughout the civil rights movement, which we see time and time again. The use of nonviolence, capitalizing on a much more technologically advanced era in American history, where the violence can be captured, forces other Americans to reassess what their role in enabling segregationists in the South truly is. And so again, what we're going to see is that the violence that happens in Selma on Bloody Sunday is going to be shared across the country on televisions and in newspapers, and people can't avoid seeing it. And so the actions that are happening in Selma, Alabama, are going to convince the federal government that the Voting Rights Act has to pass. And so there's that same theme over and over again of seeing that ultimately you use this tried and true formula of nonviolence. You have these conflict moments where ultimately black people are attacked by white segregationists in the South, and that is then shared and forces political change across the board for American society. And so it's here where I'm going to hit the pause button rather than try and get through the entire civil rights movement as a single ed puzzle. I'm hopefully condensing this to the point where no one is too grumpy. And so we're going to pick back up and see a completely different side of this coin that is the civil rights movement when we talk about the much more radical and oftentimes violent manifestations of the civil rights movement. And so we will proceed here, but I want to stop here and recognize that even going back to the death of Emmett Till, which serves as this spark to this entire movement during the late 1950s and into the 1960s, the chief goal was always end Jim Crow segregation and regain voting rights. And that does get passed with the help of not only countless lives and millions of African Americans and white people across American society, but with the help of Lyndon Johnson. I cannot stress this enough. that the help that the movement gets from LBJ with both the Civil Rights Act and the Voting Rights Act is essential to the movement's success and essential to getting these two parts of this kind of civil rights push passed through Congress. Okay, so with that, guys, we'll check in back next time. We'll have a great time. Hope y'all are having a good one.